It's our makers that need it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And a warm welcome to everyone. I'm so glad that you're here. It's good to be here today, and happy Labor Day weekend. Today we're going to talk about John the Baptist and how he lit a flame in people's hearts for God, and how we can light or relight our hearts for God. Today is Knoebel's trip in Pavilion C. Next Sunday is a big Sunday. Our Sunday school will start during worship, and also confirmation class will start, and it's grandparents' Sunday, so we'll have a special treat. I hope that will be good. Are there any announcements? And also, maybe we need next Sunday.
Yeah, mine are large.
We're having it a little bit early because we often, typically is in October, and we have crop walks and we have harvest moments then, so it seems like a lot. So that's why it's a different day. Okay, please join in the call to worship in the bulletin. Ye servants of the Lord, praise his name.
There is no one like the Lord our God.
He raises the poor from the dust.
He lifts the needy from their misery.
And makes them companions of princes.
May the Lord's name be praised now and forever.
Thank you.
Father, lift us to the joy divine. Mortals join the happy chorus, which the morning stars begin. Father, love is raining o'er us, brother, love binds men to men. Ever singing, marching, victors in the midst of strife, joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of love.
God is compassionate and loving. When we turn to Him, snoring for our sins, please join in the prayer of confession. No evil person can hide in the deepest darkness.
God removes mighty leaders.
He knows what they are like, and He wipes them out.
The persons they mistreat had prayed for Him.
God answered their prayers.
God watches everything we do.
Let us confess our sins in silence. Hear the good news. Nothing in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Through Him, our sins are forgiven. Amen.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven. Power and love. God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Please be seated. And now Susan Schagel will read the first two scriptures and I will read the gospel.
Good morning.
I don't think you need the microphone, do I? No.
Doesn't sound like it.
First, I want to say welcome back to Cheryl Hart. We're glad to have her back after knee surgery. So welcome back. Happy Sunday.
Happy Sunday.
All right, our first reading is from Exodus 16, verses 1 through 10. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt." They were set around the pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into the desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day to gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they had gathered on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, and in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, because He has heard your grumblings against Him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when He gives you meat to eat in the evening, and all the bread you want in the morning, because He has heard your grumbling against Him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for He has heard your grumbling." While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the clouds. Our second reading this morning is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And now the gospel will be read by the pastor.
Our reading from Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod Tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip Tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias Tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth, and all people will see God's salvation. This is the good news.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please join in our hymn, Jesus Walked on the Handout. Rather common for it to happen. And it's a big lantern that was lit in Greece, you know, because the lantern has to go from Greece. This is also a lantern lit from Greece, so you can light your, you give your torch light again and continue on your way. And at the 1976 Olympics in Montreal, of course, we have a big cauldron of fire in the stadium, and then it went out because it rained. And so one of the officials thought, I'll fix this, and he took his cigarette lighter and he lit the cauldron. And of course, you know, the attenders of the light, that, you know, this was horrible. They put the fire out and they lit it again with the official backup lantern. So, you know, in our life, sometimes the flame just goes out. Like we're trying to follow the Lord, but we run into difficulties too. Maybe we have the loss of a job or financial problems or illness or family issues, or we just get away from God. And that passion for God gets extinguished, or the flame gets dangerously low. And we're going to hear about John the Baptist, who got a fire going for God, stirred people up with a passion for our Lord. And I'll start by giving you a picture of passion. I got an important question. Are you a dog person? Raise your hand if you're a dog person. And are you a cat person? Raise your hand if you're a cat person. You can raise both if you're both. Some of those too. So I'm going to tell you about a diary of a dog and a diary of a cat. So here's the diary of a dog. He says, 8 a.m. dog food, my favorite thing. 9 a.m. car ride, my favorite thing. 10 a.m. walk in the park, my favorite thing. 11 a.m. ears and belly rubbed, my favorite thing. 1 o'clock, play in the yard, my favorite thing. 5 o'clock, dog biscuit, my favorite thing. 7 o'clock, play ball, my favorite thing. 8 o'clock, watch TV with my people, my favorite thing. 11 p.m., get in my bed, my favorite thing. And then here's the diary of a cat. Day 953 of my captivity. My captors continued to torment me with bizarre dangling objects. The only thing that keeps me going is my dream of escape. So you have two animal diaries and very different points of view. And, you know, there's also a dog theology and a cat theology. Like, a dog looks at you and says, you feed me, you love me, you take care of me, you house me, you must be God. And the cat has a different theology. The cat looks at you and says, you feed me, you love me, you take care of me, you house me, I must be God. So sometimes in life, you know, I think we find ourselves living in the cat theology, where we make it all about us, and I want you to have your flame lit for God, where it's all about Him. And today, we'll see how John the Baptist was all about God and on fire for the Lord. The gospel starts in Luke 3. When Pontius Pilate was governor, when Herod was tetrarch, and Philip and Lysanias were tetrarchs, and Annas and Caiaphas were high priests, there were a lot of people, important people in that introduction, rulers and high priests. They have position and power and authority. And then there was John the Baptist. But, you know, it says the word of God doesn't come to these people in high positions. At that time, when all of them were in power, the word of God came to John the Baptist in the wilderness. And for John, it wasn't all about him. John is not trying to be important in the world's eyes. He's pointing to God and preaching a back develops the spirit in us. It's where Moses and the people of Israel wandered for 40 years while God prepared them for the promised land. And the wilderness is where the prophet Elijah heard from God at a very low point when he was ready to give up. The wilderness is where the Holy Spirit prepared Jesus for ministry and where he was tempted by the devil. Luke 3:4 says, John was the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And there were plenty of teachers and high priests and religious leaders in Jerusalem. But there wasn't much action for God taking place in the wilderness. And John knew about Jerusalem and the temple and all of that. That's where an angel appeared to his father in the temple in Jerusalem. And the angel said, "Good news, your wife is going to have the child you've both been waiting for, a son, and he'll be filled with the Holy Spirit, and he will bring many people back to God." So John knew about Jerusalem, but God called him to be a voice in the wilderness. And John teaches us you don't need a really special time or place, that now is the time, and here is the place to turn to God. We don't need to wait until a season when we're less busy, or we don't need to wait to get our fire started until, you know, we can make it to church more often, or until we understand the Bible better. But now is the time, and here is the place. And when we want to rekindle that flame with God, I think about, you know, if we wanted to rekindle our marriage, we probably know how to do that. You know, you might take your spouse out to eat. You wouldn't do takeout. You know, you sit in the restaurant over a meal. You put your phone away. You turn it off. You look into your spouse's eyes and maybe hold their hand a little bit. And that's something that you can't outsource. You know, you can't ask your best friend to take your spouse on a date for you, right? You have to be the one. You have to be present. And so when we restart a flame for God, we can't just outsource it to, you know, the pastor will preach on Sunday, although I think that's good that you're here. But more than that, you know, gathering together is very important. It's important also when you go home to keep that flame for God going during the week, to walk with God, to talk with him, and be present with him. In order to renew your relationship with the Lord, now is the time, and here is the place. Take your problems to God. He will make it a lot easier to live with those problems and to get you through them. So my challenge for you is to be like the dog who wrote a dog diary, who has dog theology, who said, "Wow, you know, God is good. I love you, God." You know, to give God a shout out, a hug of gratitude each day. Listen to what God has to say and be present to him. So I want you to tell some people around you, your best dog voice, you know, "Wow, God is good." So tell some people.
I can only think of a cat because we're cats. And it's so much right on.
So the Lord, through John the Baptist, was fanning the flames of his spirit in the wilderness, which is often a place we want to run away from. Or if we do go to the wilderness, it's just for a little while. You know, we want to come back. You know, we don't want to live in a tent permanently. But John went out and he found God there in the wilderness. And God gave John a voice in the wilderness. And he brought people back to God. So if you feel like your fire has gone out or is getting low, he wants to help. Come to him and he'll give you his spirit. God will give you a fresh passion, a joy, and a new heart. Amen. Please stand and join as we sing to you.
believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Holy God, we come to you in thanks and praise, for you who are mighty and over all the earth. You bring good into our lives. You create us and call us to serve you and others. But we thank you for the wilderness. Thank you that you're everywhere that we go, that you want to walk and talk with us. We ask you to help us to open up our hearts, to look for you and come to you each day. We live our best lives when we realize that life is not all about ourselves, but it's about you. Help us to live for your purposes. We pray for all who are dealing with and recovering from disasters, from fire and floods and wind. We pray for children in school, for teachers and staff, for a great year ahead. We ask for healing for all who are ill, especially healing for Lynn Hill. And we pray for those who mourn, especially the family of Lee Halls. And we lift up to you now our prayer requests and our thanksgiving for all the blessings you give, and we do so in silence. In all this we pray in Jesus' name. God has blessed us. We return that blessing as we receive our offering. pray and thanksgiving for all who labor, and we ask that our gifts of these monetary donations and of our very lives will give glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And also with you.
We lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to God most high.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of Jesus, our Savior. In obedience to you, he suffered on the cross, was raised from the dead, and delivered us from sin and death. With your people of faith, in all times, we praise you with joy.
Holy God, we come to your table to be fed the true bread of eternal life. With all the saints on heaven and earth, we glorify you. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Please be seated. You remember on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and after giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Let us pray the prayer our Savior taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are ready. The ushers may come forward.
teach our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Now go forth in the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Stay.